Genesis 14. Abraham's life demonstrates the principles for a breakthrough to financial favor. As we study the life of Abraham, we realize that Abram never sought wealth. He never sought to be wealthy. He never sought to be rich. What Abraham did was Abraham sought God. God was his provider, and he understood that well. It would be well for us to understand it as well. I want to ask a question. How many of you have received a financial breakthrough this week, a specific blessing this week? Let me see your hands. Praise the Lord. Let me give you a testimony real quickly about a young man in the church, owns his own business. He's a chiropractor, owns his own business. And he came to one of our pastors and asked for prayer last Sunday or two Sundays ago. And the pastor prayed for him. They prayed together. They agreed together. And the pastor was led by the Holy Spirit to ask. This man had invoiced patients who hadn't paid him. And the pastor was inspired by the Holy Spirit to pray that not only would God bring the wealth back, that God would help the patients to pay, but he said, let it begin tomorrow, Monday. Let it begin tomorrow morning. And he came Wednesday night to tell this pastor. He said, can I tell you something? He said, Monday morning, I went to the mail and people started paying their bills. That is a financial breakthrough. Breakthrough to financial favor. And I'm just here to tell you, God is no respecter of persons. God doesn't care if you give $1 million or $1. If you give it in faith, God said, I'll bless your life. See, I don't believe in luck. I don't believe in luck. I don't believe in being at the right place at the right time. I don't believe in good luck. I don't believe in bad luck. I don't believe in karma. I believe in the divine favor of God. And I believe that his divine favor is in my life, and his divine favor is in every one of your lives as well. And I believe that God desires to bring a breakthrough in all of our being today. You see, I believe in a strategic God who has strategic plans. He knows where he's going. Aren't you glad? And he knows where he's taking every one of us. He is strategic. He has a plan. You've got a problem today? God has a plan. You've got a need today? God has a plan. If you are despised today, God has a plan. And the Bible says, early in Scripture, the Bible says, I know the plans I have for you. I think what's important is that we know God has plans for us. And then he says they're good plans, not plans to harm you, not plans to hurt you, not plans to destroy you, but plans to bless your life. And I'm just here to tell you this morning, I expect God's favor in my life. But not only is God a strategic God who has strategic plans for our life, but I believe that his plans include a breakthrough to financial blessing in your life. We've studied Abraham's life. And Abraham's life demonstrates the principles for a breakthrough to financial blessing. And we've been covering this. We've been walking with Abraham from the moment that God said, Abraham, leave everything you have. Leave it behind. Leave your social security behind. Leave your business behind. Leave your family behind and follow me. Now, if God gave me that kind of challenge, my first question would be, where are we going? And then my second question will be, how do I know when I get there? You remember, some of you remember, we used to take driving trips. We didn't fly back in the day. We drove everywhere. Thousands of miles we'd drive. And I remember being in the car and asking my dad that very important question. Are we there yet? Only to hear him say, we'll be there in a little while. A minute later, are we there yet? We'll be there in a little while. A few minutes later, are we there yet? I'll tell you when we get there, he would say. But God trusted Abraham. And all along the way, different principles were taught about God's hand upon Abraham's life. The first principle that we discovered is Abraham followed hard after God. Abraham never sought wealth. Abraham sought God. As you read the scripture about Abraham's life, it appears as though Abraham's number one priority over everything else is to be in the will of God, to follow the Lord, to know where God was leading him and be willing to follow where God led. If it cost him everything, he would lay everything aside to follow God. If it cost him his life, he was not a perfect man. The scripture proves that. But still, he followed hard after God. Psalm 63:8 says, my soul follows hard. That's a principle from beginning to end. My soul follows hard after you, and your right hand upholds me. In essence, the psalmist was saying, I will follow you. I will make you my priority. You are the first thing I think about in the morning, the last thing I think about at night. And God responds to that by saying, I'll meet every need of your life. The second principle that we learned through Abraham's life is that we must develop a personal confidence or trust in God. It's not a matter of what somebody tells you. It's not a matter of what your family tells you, what your church tells you. It's a matter of a personal trust, confidence. I believe in God. And I can just tell you, unless you're a person of the Word, you can't be a person of faith. The more we're in the Word, the more we read the Word, the more we digest, spiritually digest the Word, the more faith is built in our heart, the more confidence we have in God. Until we're willing to take that first step. God says move, and we take that first step. God says do, and we're willing to do what He asks us to do. And in the obedience comes that trust that we have in God. Proverbs 3, verse 5 and 6 says, trust in the Lord with all of your heart. And then he says, don't depend upon your own understanding, your own knowledge, your own education, your own experience, or anybody else for that matter. He said, in all your ways, acknowledge him, and he will direct your path. The third principle that we learned through Abraham's life was that you have to be willing to choose God over your senses. There's always that time where your mind tells you one thing, but God tells you something else. Where your intellect tells you one thing and God tells you something else. Where your education tells you one thing and God tells you something else. Where everybody else tells you something, but God tells you something else. And in that moment, we have a decision to make. Do I trust in myself? Do I trust in my education? Do I trust in my own experience? Or do I trust in God? Peter was a fisherman. If anybody knew the characteristics of water, Peter would have known them. And yet, when Jesus said to Peter, come, Peter jumped out of the boat and he began to walk on water. Intellectually, Peter knew you don't walk on water. Experience told him you don't walk on water. But when Jesus said, come, Peter had a decision and he said, I'm going to trust God over my senses. 1 Kings chapter 6, verse 16. The prophet Elisha told his servant, don't be afraid of them. When the armies had surrounded their home and would come to capture the prophet to make him their secret weapon, the servant of the prophet was so afraid because there were so many armies coming to capture them. The prophet said to his servant, don't be afraid. The army that fights for us is larger than the army that fights against us. Every one of his senses told him that we're going to be destroyed. Everything in his mind told him that we would not prevail. But God said, I will prevail against the enemy. So we come to our fourth principle. Now understand with me, we're talking about breakthrough to financial favor. And in the last 3 weeks, I never once talked about money. Because financial favor, financial blessing, has nothing to do with money. It has everything to do with attitude. Nothing to do with money, everything to do with attitude. Here's the principle. Choose to extend your hand to God as He extends His hand to you. Choose to extend an open hand to God as He extends a full hand to you. It's a principle when it comes to stewardship. It's amazing to me. And we come to a point now where we're going to talk about money. You know, it's amazing. In some churches, you talk about healing and everybody erupts in joy. Shay! You talk about breakthrough to relationships. Yay! You talk about money. Silence. As I said earlier, there are some pastors that are so afraid to take up an offering. I have heard pastors apologize for taking up an offering. I'm sorry we've got to take up an offering this morning, but you know, we got to pay the bills and there are just things we got to do, so let's take up an offering and, you know, thank you in advance for giving and I guess we'll just go on. No, heavens no. What a sad commentary of faith in God when you receive an offering or give an offering that way. There are some churches that the minute somebody talks about receiving an offering, it gets really quiet. Talk about budget, which we did last Sunday. It gets really quiet. I can tell you something. You can rejoice in God's provision in your finances as much as you can rejoice in God's provision for your healing. He is as good in finances as he has in health. Praise the Lord. So smile at me. Some of you just scared to death right now. Some of you grabbed a hold of your wallet and you ain't letting it go. It's all right. It's okay. It's okay. Abraham demonstrated something to us. Abraham was willing to extend his hand as God extended his hand. Randy Alcorn said, the more you give, the more comes back to you. Somebody say amen to that. Amen. The more you give, the more comes back to you, because God is the greatest giver in the universe. And he won't let you outgive him. And then Randy issues a challenge, as God does. He said, go ahead and try and see what happens. The Bible talks about that, doesn't it? Try me in this. Test me. In other words, God says, I know what I'm going to do. What are you going to do? I know how I'm going to respond. How are you going to respond? Here is an eternal truth that seems to evade so many Christians. We trust God with our eternal soul. We come to the Lord and we cry out, God, forgive me. And we do that often too, don't we? Forgive me, Lord. And we receive by faith, we receive that grace, abounding in grace. We thank God for that grace. We thank God that he lavishes that upon us. We trust him with our eternal soul. But when it comes to our money, boy, we grab a hold of that and keep it tight. Now, why in the world could I trust him with eternity and not trust him with today? Could I not trust him with my tomorrows as well? This eternal truth that just escaped so many believers, and that is this: give and you shall receive, and I'll add, abundantly. Give and you will receive. See, that is so contrary to the world. Remember, we said before, you've got to choose to accept God's plan. You've got to choose to accept God's way. You've got to choose to accept God's word over your senses. In the world, the whole premise of the world is get more, get more, get more. And once you get it, baby, hold on to it, because somebody wants to take it away from you. And the more you get, the more you have. So we strive to get more and get more and get more and hold on to more and hold on to more, for he who has more wins. But that's not the principle of God's word. God's word says the more you give, the more you'll receive in abundance. Not one for one, not dollar for dollar, not moment for moment, not day for day, year for year, but in abundance, God says, I will pour out my provision in your life. But we lose that. We've lost that. When I say we, I don't mean we. I mean in general, Christians, some Christians, have gotten to a point where they'll give God everything except their finances. And today's economy, hear me, in today's economy, sometimes we're willing to give our money, but we're not willing to give our time. Time has become so precious to us. Give and you will receive again. Let's read our text. Genesis chapter 14, but let me offer a word of prayer. Father, we're going to read the scripture today, and there are many, I think, may be intimidated by this message even before it's spoken. There are many, Father, who have become defensive even before the word has been spoken. And Father, you understand that. The Bible says you remember us. You remember that we are dust. You know what we go through. You know what we face. But Father, your word is an eternal word. And it comes down to one word: trust. And I pray as we read the word today, Heavenly Father, that you bring revelation to our lives. That if we come to you with a tight fist, I pray, Lord, that as we read the scripture and say to ourselves, I will obey even if I don't understand. I will try it even though I don't know that it will work, and we're willing to release to you, your hand will always come in provision in our life. So Holy Spirit, teach us. Holy Spirit, reveal to us. And Holy Spirit, set us free. In Jesus' name, amen. Genesis chapter 14, we're talking about Abraham. Now, let me just quickly say, to the point we've gotten in the scripture today, Abraham was asked to leave and he left. He came to a point where his nephew that he brought with him, Lot, were being so blessed, so abundantly provided, so wealthy that their herdsmen began to fight over the grassland because there just wasn't enough. God was multiplying everything. And so Abraham said to his nephew Lot, you choose where you go and I'll go the other way because we're family and we're not going to fight. We're not going to contend with each other. So he took Lot to a place. He said, Lot, you look and you see. If you go right, I'll go left. You go left, I'll go right. You go north, I'll go south. You choose, Lot. And the Bible tells us that Lot was as blessed as Abraham. Lot was prosperous. Lot was prospering in everything. But Lot didn't understand something. Lot's blessing didn't come because of him. Lot's blessing came because of Abraham. Lot's blessing didn't come become because he worked hard, because he was a good businessman. Lot's blessing was because he was connected to Abraham. And so Lot was given a choice. What did he do? He chose the best for himself. A little bit selfish, I think. He saw that the land was filled with water and grassland, and it would be pleasing to the eye, and it would be successful. So he chose that. And Abraham just trusted God. Abraham had already discovered if Lot chooses the valley and God gives the desert to Abraham, that God would cause the desert to blossom and bloom. And he did. God did. But as Abraham chose the choicest land for himself, being self-centered, thinking that it was all about Lot, Lot lost everything. Everything. All of his land, all of his sheep, all of his family. He even lost his freedom. Four kings came down and destroyed and captured him and took him away. Abraham found out about it. Abraham went in. Hear me. Four kings and kingdoms went against five kings and five kingdoms, and the four kings beat the five kings. You got to know they had a big army. You had to know their army was powerful. Their army was tested. So what did Abraham do? Did he hire an army? No. What he did was he took 350 servants and he went out and he destroyed the four kings. And this is where we come in. Let's read now. Verse 16. They recovered all of the plunder along with the nephew Lot and his possessions, including the women and excuse me, women and the people. In other words, they took back everything. They brought Lot back. They brought his stuff back. Verse 17, and Abram returned from defeating the kings and his allied kings. The king of Sodom came out to greet him. This is where Lot lived. Came out to greet him in the valley of Sheba, the king's valley. And I want you to listen to this name. Keep this name in mind. Melchizedek, king of Salem, brought out bread and wine. He was the priest of the Most High God and blessed Abraham. Blessed be Abraham by the high God, creator of heaven and earth, and blessed be the God of the high God who handed your enemies over to you. And now listen to these words. Abraham gave him a tenth of all the recovered plunder. First place in the Bible you hear the word tithe. Though stewardship is found throughout the Bible, from Genesis, and we'll talk about that in a moment. He tithed to Melchizedek. First place in the Bible talks about the actual tithe being presented. He gave him a tenth of all the recovered. Now take a deep breath. It's going to be okay. Verse 21, and the king of Sodom said to Abraham, give me back the people, but keep all of the plunder for yourself. Now, in this day of time, it would have been right. In military terms, in biblical times, when a kingdom would fight against another kingdom and they would capture or defeat that kingdom, they would not only take back what was theirs, they would take other stuff too. Children of Israel, when they came out of Egypt, what did they do? The Egyptians gave them stuff as they just get out of here. Take whatever you want and get out. They took plunder. The plunder was the advancement. The plunder was the blessing. The plunder was the first fruits. And so as they took that together, the king of Sodom said, here, Abraham, just give me back what was taken from me. Just return what was taken and everything else you can have. And listen to what he said. But Abraham told the king of Sodom, I swear by God, the high God, the creator of heaven and earth, this solemn oath, I'll take nothing from you. not so much as a thread or a shoestring. And here's why. I'm not going to have you go around saying, I made Abraham rich. See, Abraham knew where his wealth came from. Abraham knew where his provision came from. Abraham did not pursue wealth. Abraham pursued God. And because he ran hard after God, God made sure he had plenty of everything. Nothing for me, he goes on. Nothing for me other than what the young man ate and the share of the men who went with me there to get their share of the plunder. In other words, Abraham said, I'll take nothing for myself. In fact, not only will I take nothing, I'm going to give you Melchizedek. I'm going to give you a tenth of all of the plunder. And then he said, the only thing that I will receive is not for me, but for my 350 men. He said, they can have a share of what was left over. That's like you work for a company and they're in sales. And you just made the biggest sale of the company's history. A $3 million sale. And the profit of that $3 million sales was $1 million in the pocket of the owner of the company. But the owner, rather than saying, I'll take my profit, he says to you and all of the salespeople, he says to you, you know, I've been blessed. I've been provided. All of the profits from this sale go to you. You share it equally. Well, now, how many of you like to work for a boss like that, huh? Abraham understood that his blessing did not come by the might of men. His blessing did not come because a war was won. His blessings came from God. As Abraham continued to be blessed, what did he do? Did he take more? No. Did he strive for more? No. Did he work harder to gain more? No. What did Abraham do as God continued to bless him? Abraham gave more. Isn't that interesting? Isn't it interesting? The provision of everything earthly, everything Western culture is, keep it for yourself. For the more you possess, the richer you are. But Abraham understood something. It's not what was in his hand. It was what was in God's hand. And he said to the king of Sodom, he said, look, this war wasn't won. In essence, he said, this war wasn't won because I'm a mighty man. This war wasn't won because of my technology or because of my wisdom. This war was won because God is my provider. God delivered me. And you didn't deliver me, Sodom. You didn't deliver me, O king. In fact, you got whooped. God brought freedom. God brought liberty into my life. God, Abraham, trusted God. And so as he was blessed and blessed and blessed, what did he do? He gave more. In other words, Abraham wasn't tight-fisted. Abraham was open-handed. If you were to have somebody walk up to you, you were standing on a street corner, and a stranger walked up to you, and as he walked up to you, he clenched his fist like this, what would you do? Run, that's about right, I do too. And if you didn't run, you'd at least prepare yourself because clenched fist means something. Usually it means it's on. And I got to tell you, somebody comes at me like that, I'm going to be praying in the spirit, and I might be clenching my fist too, I don't know. But that means battle. And spiritually speaking, when we clench our fist, what we're saying is, it's mine. It's mine. Well, brother and sister, understand this. If you're a child of God, it's not yours. You didn't get it on your own. Again, I believe in a strategic God. You didn't get that job because you were all that. You got that job because God led you there. You didn't get that goodbye on that home because you were good with finances and the banks just happened to grace you. You're there because God put you there. A strategic God who always comes to us with open hands. But in his hands is always something good. I like that story of that little boy. His father told him, he said, I've got some candy for you. Little boy said, okay. Father brought out a jar and he said, I want you to reach in and grab some candy. And that little boy reached in that jar, grabbed that candy, but couldn't get his hand out. Couldn't get his hand out because his fist was clenched. His dad said, let go of the candy, but you said it's mine. Let go of the candy, but you said I could have it. Let go of the candy, no! But finally, the little boy acquiesced and he let go of the candy and pulled his hand out. And the father took that jar and said, now open your hands. And he poured the candy into his son's hands. That's the way it is with God sometimes. We come to God and we come with closed fists. It's mine. And God says, let it go. How many times do we hold on to little things when God has big things to give us? We hold on to the small things when God has the larger things to bless us with. It's mine. And sometimes we do that not because we're bad people, but because we're afraid. What happens if I let it go? What happens to me if I let go of this? Who'll take care of me? And over in the scripture, God says, I'll take care of you. When we come to God with an open hand, God always comes to us with his hand open. And can I tell you something? God's hands are bigger than your hands. And in God's hands are more than what's in your hands. So who was Melchizedek, king of Salem? That's who Abraham paid a tithe to. And that represents something, something that we need to gain and need to understand within our hearts and our minds as well. Here's who Melchizedek was, first one to receive the tithe, Melchizedek. He was King Melchizedek. The word Melchizedek means righteousness. So he was king of righteousness. He was also king of Salem, a region that later became Jerusalem. And he was king of Salem, which was king of peace. Now that's interesting, isn't it? King of righteousness, king of peace, but what else? He was a high priest. Here was a man who believed in God, who believed in Jehovah. Here's a man who had accepted that God was the principle of all the universe. Hebrews chapter 6, verse 20 says, where Jesus has gone as a forerunner on our behalf, having become a high priest forever after the order of who? Melchizedek. Now, here's what's interesting. He's the king of righteousness. He's the king of peace. And he's a high priest. Who does that begin to sound like to you? Jesus. He wasn't Jesus. In fact, Melchizedek was a distinct link to Jesus. He was a pre-incarnate representation of Jesus Christ. And you find that throughout the Old Testament. Over and over again, you find someone or something that would represent, prophets would declare who Jesus was. This was 500, 600, 700 years before the birth of Christ. They would proclaim, this is the Lord. There would be something. Can I just tell you? The sacrificial lamb was a type of Jesus, who became the sacrifice for all of the sins of humanity. Over and over again, God gave us a type, a symbol, a representation of Jesus Christ. And in this place, we see that Melchizedek was that representation. Hebrews chapter 7, verse 3. He is without, speaking of Melchizedek, he is without father or mother or genealogy, having neither beginning of days nor end of life, but resembling the Son of God, he continues a priest forever. But here's what we've got to glean from this. Not just that Melchizedek represented Jesus, but we've got to glean from this that Abraham paid his tithes to Melchizedek. Who are you paying your tithes to? Some people are paying their tithes to the church. Wrong. Some people are paying their tithes to a pastor. Really wrong. Some people are paying their tithes to an organization. Wrong. Some people are paying their tithes to a denomination. Wrong. Who are we paying our tithes to? Who are we giving to? Who are we stretching our hand to? Jesus. Jesus. It was as though symbolically that as Abraham put that plunder in the hand of Melchizedek, we are putting our tithes, our offerings, we are putting our blessing into the hand of Jesus Christ. You see, when I get that, when I understand that truth, when I get that, when I grasp that, then my giving is more than just an obligatory offering, just an obligatory throwing something in the offering plate. It is a presentation of my life to Jesus Christ. My rejoicing to Jesus. I've got to go quickly here. As a consequence of Abraham's continued prosperity, what did he do? He gave. Why is that so difficult today? Why is it so difficult for some today to be willing to give to God? Luke chapter 6, verse 38. Give, and it will be given to you. How? Pressed down. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over, will be put into your lap. For with the measure you use, it will be measured to you back. When I was a little boy, I used to watch my mother cook, bake. Mother was a great cook. I mean, just great cook. She was Norwegian descent and just... But I would watch my mother, and she would bake, and sometimes when she was baking something, she would take a container And she would pour the ingredients into the container, and then she would take a spoon and she would press it down. She would pour it up to the top, and sometimes she would take a knife and she would scrape it off the top just to make it level. And then she would take a spoon and she'd press it down. You know what she did next? She'd pour more into the container. And after she poured more, she'd press it down with that spoon, and then she'd pour more. And I used to wonder, why are you pressing it down like that? I know now. Because when you press it down, it makes room for more. And the Bible says, shaken together. Now, some of you are old enough to remember the oil crisis in the 70s, in the late 70s. The Iranian oil embargo that created such an uproar in our nation, where there would be long lines at the gas station, and they even rationed gas in the United States, rationed gas. If your license plate ended on an even number, you could get gas on even days and odd number on odd days. You couldn't get gas anytime you wanted to. And sometimes if you needed gas, there was a long line, you had to wait. There were people that pushed their cars to the pump because they'd run out of gas. I had a little Volkswagen convertible. Little bug, and it held 10 gallons of gas, just a little bit more if you top it off. But I remember one day I was standing in line waiting. I was watching people do it, and people would put the gas in and then they'd shake the car. Somebody else put the gas in and shake the car, and I wonder, what in the world are they doing? And I asked one guy, why are you shaking your car? What's that all about? He said, I'm shaking to get the air out so I can get more gas in. Well, that's what I begin to do. Can I tell you, I do that to this very day. Put my big rear end up against the car, shake it a little bit, and it moves, and then put more gas in. That's what the scripture is talking about, not gasoline, but shaking together. Why? To make room for more. And he said, with the same measure, large or small, open-handed or tight fist, with the same measure that you give, he said, I'll give back to you again. John MacArthur said, I love this quote, and it's a sad quote, frankly. God made all of creation to give. Wow. We're out of time. Let me finish this statement. God made all of creation to give. He made the sun, the moon, the stars, the clouds, the earth, the plants to give. He also designed his supreme creation, man, to give. But fallen man is the most reluctant giver in all of God's creation. Why? Why are we so reluctant to give? I've got more to share, but I gotta stop. I'm just here to tell you, giving is not about money. Giving is about attitude. Giving isn't about an attitude of thanksgiving. Giving is about an attitude of investment. Giving is about an attitude of obedience. Giving is an attitude of trust. And when I master that, I don't come to God with a closed fist. I come to God with an open hand. In my hand is what God has asked for, but in his hand is so much more. Father, we love you this morning and thank you for your blessing and goodness in our life. I thank you, Heavenly Father, that there is no subject that you are timid about. Father, I thank you that you have given us instruction. This word is not a word that comes from a man. It's not a word that comes from a denomination or a committee that tries to, well, how can we raise funds? This is the word of God. And Father, I pray, I thank you that Braeswood is a generous congregation. But I know there are some here, Lord, that are struggling with this. And rather than looking for loopholes by saying this is Old Testament, when in reality, Father, the first issue of stewardship came at the garden where Jesus said, where Father said, you're here, you be blessed by it, but you take care of it. Where tithing came with Abraham and Jacob 300 to 400 years before the law was ever given. I pray you'll bring a release to every person in this room. And Father, with the jar of blessing, may our hand never be closed. But may we open our hand then to receive as you pour out the blessings into our life. We give you honor and praise for it in Jesus' name. Amen. I believe in a breakthrough to financial favor.